Now that you have learned how to diagnose a plant disease, you can institute measures to manage it. Accurate disease diagnosis is an essential part of effective management. In our experience, failure to adequately manage a disease can often be traced back to a failure to correctly diagnose the problem. Once a disease is properly diagnosed, a reasonable disease management program can be developed with resources like books, fact sheets, the internet, and extension professionals. I'm Dr. DeBusk, and in this video, I'll talk about managing plant diseases. A favorable environment is needed for plant disease to develop. For example, soybean and the white mold fungus must interact in cool, moist conditions during flowering in order for disease, white mold, to occur. A favorable environment is critically important for disease development. Even the most susceptible plants exposed to huge amounts of a pathogen will not develop disease unless environmental conditions are favorable. Temperature and moisture are the most important environmental factors that affect development of nearly all diseases. Both air or soil temperature and moisture can affect plants and/or the pathogen. If temperature is unsuitable, a plant may grow poorly and therefore become more susceptible to a particular disease. Temperature may also stimulate or reduce the growth of a pathogen, resulting in a different level of disease. Excess or deficient moisture may also stress plants, making them more prone to attack by some pathogens. Additionally, moisture is important for many fungal and bacterial pathogens. Relative humidity, soil pH, soil texture, light, and nutrient status may affect disease development as well. Moreover, such factors as compaction, tillage practices, planting depth, seedbed preparation, and residue management can have significant effects on disease development. The disease triangle is an important concept in plant pathology. Disease will only occur if three factors interact simultaneously. A susceptible host plant, a pathogen, and a favorable environment are the three factors composing the plant disease triangle. All three factors are necessary for development of a plant disease. Thus, disease can be affected by altering any of these three factors. For example, the host plant can be changed by growing disease-resistant varieties. The pathogen can be removed by tilling residue, rotating crops so that pathogens do not survive year to year on the same crop, controlling insects that carry pathogens to plants, or using fungicides to kill the pathogen. Finally, the environment can be managed so that it is less favorable for disease, such as changing row spacing or draining low areas. In this example of soybean rust, soybean host must be planted, spores, pathogen of the soybean rust fungus must be present, and the soybean leaves have to be wet for a minimum of 8 hours environment to enable the spores to germinate and infect the leaf. When the three factors come together, they may result in the disease, in this case, soybean rust. Disease development occurs over a period of time as a series of events. The series of events is called the disease cycle. The basic steps in most disease cycles are as follows: production of inoculum, spread of inoculum to susceptible host, penetration of inoculum into host, infection, secondary cycles, and pathogen survival between host plants. The rest of this video will further explain this process. Knowing the disease cycle is important in managing any disease. Depending on the disease, management will target certain stages of that disease's development. Management options that break the disease cycle prevent or reduce development of the disease. The goal of plant disease management, therefore, is to interrupt the disease cycle and stop it from completing a full cycle. It is important to understand that the disease cycle of each disease to make the most effective management decisions. Inoculum is the potential infective units of a pathogen, including fungal spores and bacterial cells. Dispersal is the movement of inoculum. Infection is the pathogen penetrating into the host plant. Colonization is the pathogen establishing itself in the host plant. These four types of pathogens share certain characteristics regarding the disease cycle. Fungi, bacteria, and nematodes often survive in crop residue or in the soil. Viruses and bacteria often survive in insect vectors. Fungi, bacteria, and viruses can be dispersed by insects. Only fungi and bacteria are dispersed by rain or wind. Fungi and nematodes are able to directly infect the host, while bacteria and viruses infect the host indirectly via insect feeding, for example. Inoculum is the form of a pathogen that is capable of causing infection, including spores and bacterial cells. Spread of inoculum may occur by wind, water, infected plant material, insects, animals, birds, and people. Plant diseases may have more than one source of inoculum. For example, Xanthomonas wilt disease, a banana, can be moved by rain, infected by suckers, transmitted by farm tools, or carried by insects or birds. Knowing how a pathogen is spread can be valuable information when planning a disease management program. For example, it may be difficult to control the spread of pathogens by wind or water, but it is possible to control movement of diseased seed or infected plant material, to restrict movement of pathogens on equipment or tools, and to reduce levels of insect vectors or shift planting dates to avoid high populations of insect vectors. Infection occurs when a pathogen successfully enters a plant and grows, reproduces, and spreads within the plant. Pathogens enter a host through natural openings, wounds on plant surfaces, or by penetrating directly into the plant. Insect vectors may acquire pathogens from diseased plant tissue as they feed, and then introduce the pathogen into healthy plant tissue as they feed on the healthy plant. Some pathogens attack and multiply only in leaf tissue. Others attack and multiply in stems, roots, fruits, or the conducting tissue of the plant. Another type may attack virtually the entire plant, while some attack only seedlings or mature plants, and some have no preference. The period between infection and first symptoms is the incubation period. The length of the incubation period may range from days to weeks or even months, depending on the pathogen and host plant involved. Diseases with repeating cycles produce additional inoculum in or on the diseased plant. The secondary inoculum is spread to other parts of the same plant or to adjacent plants, leading to another cycle of penetration, infection, symptom development, inoculum production, and so on. Two or more cycles of disease development may occur in a season. The image shows secondary spores produced on the underside of a soybean leaf, downy mildew, and soybean rust. These spores can cause disease on new leaves during the same growing season. For plant diseases to occur season after season, pathogens must have some means of surviving from one growing season to the next, or until a favorable host crop is grown again. Many fungi and nematodes enter stages that enable them to survive extreme temperature and moisture conditions in the soil. Others persist in crop residues year after year. Burying crop residue can decrease survivability of the pathogen. Some survive in or on seed and may cause disease when infected seed is planted. Some pathogens overwinter in the bodies of insect vectors and are spread when insects feed on susceptible hosts the next spring. Many rust spores survive in the south and are carried north by winds each growing season. Several management practices are used to reduce plant disease. Often they are used in combination. The goal of any practice should be to break the disease cycle. Management practices that are used include variety selection, insect and weed management, cultural practices, good agronomics, and fungicides. We will discuss each of these in more detail over the next several slides. Variety selection should be the cornerstone of disease management. Planting disease-resistant varieties can go a long way to reducing disease. Resistance can work in a number of ways. One way is by preventing colonization and subsequent disease development. For example, if a plant is resistant to soybean cyst nematode, the nematodes are unable to establish feeding sites in the soybean cyst nematode-resistant soybeans, and therefore the nematodes die. For plant species that are susceptible to a particular plant pathogen, plant breeders strive to select varieties, cultivars, of the plant that have resistance to plant diseases. Many varieties of vegetable and ornamental plants with some level of resistance to the targeted plant pathogen can be found. Merely choosing and planting these varieties will reduce disease problems. This is your first line of defense. There are also varieties that show more tolerance for specific diseases. In spite of the fact that these plants may seem to have as many symptoms as those that are not tolerant, somehow they still thrive and produce. For example, corn plants resistant to the pathogen that causes northern leaf spot will get infected and colonized, but the lesions are smaller, less distinct than on the susceptible hybrids, and produce fewer spores. Likewise, plants that are adapted for the local environment are more likely to remain disease-free than non-adapted plants, especially for ornamental plants. This is often referred to as selecting the right plant for the site. A plant that prefers well-drained soils will not thrive in a site that is often waterlogged. Plants that prefer low pH soil, acid soil, will not thrive in an alkaline soil, high pH soil. In these situations, the plants are weakened and may develop diseases they would otherwise resist. This is even true for native plants, which are not just native to Florida, but also to a particular environment, swamp, sand, rock, salt spray, etc. Some pathogens infect seed and reduce germination or slow seedling growth. Planting high-quality seed reduces disease. In addition, using high-quality seed may prevent introduction of new pathogens into a field. The left image shows purple seed stain on soybean, which is caused by a fungus leading to Cercospora blight. The right image shows structures for white mold. These survival structures, sclerotia, can move with seed and survive in soil for several years. Weed management is important. Many of the weeds that commonly occur are also hosts of some pathogens. For example, Desmodium species are hosts of bean pod model virus that affects soybean. Therefore, these hosts enable the pathogen to produce more inoculum. Furthermore, weeds may improve the microclimate for spore production by increasing relative humidity and/or decreasing light intensity. The image shows Desmodium species. Some viruses can live in the absence of one host by colonizing another host. Then, when a crop host is present, the virus can move from weed host to crop host in various ways. Insects can be a source of inoculum. Insects can carry fungal pathogen spores on their bodies or may carry bacterial or virus pathogens inside them. For example, the corn flea beetle carries the Stewart disease bacterium that infects corn. Feeding by the corn flea beetle wounds corn leaf tissues, allowing the bacterium which is carried by the beetle to enter the plant. Furthermore, some insects can cause wounds in plants that allow pathogens to enter the host plant. For example, corn stalk borers can wound corn, leading to stalk rot. Corn pith tissue damaged by stalk rots is discolored and can lead to lodging. Some soybean diseases like sudden death syndrome and brown stem rot are more severe when high numbers of soybean cyst nematodes are present. Thus, interactions can occur between two different types of pathogens that can result in greater disease severity. One of the most important cultural practices that may be used for disease management is crop rotation. Many pathogens can only survive on infested crop residue for a limited period of time. The reason for this is that saprophytic organisms that survive by feeding on dead organic matter, microorganisms, are better at competing for food and may even destroy or suppress a pathogen. For example, the fungus Trichoderma parzianum is pathogenic to the pathogen causing Rhizoctonia root rot. In the right image, there are other microorganisms present in the environment which compete for food resources better than pathogens, leaving the pathogen with no resources to survive on. Tillage is another excellent disease management tool. Tillage reduces surface residue by burying it and thus removes the source of inoculum from contact with the host. Buried crop residue also decomposes quicker than residue left on the soil surface and thereby reduces survival of the pathogen. For example, many corn foliar diseases may be more severe if previously infected residue remains on the surface. Conservation tillage may promote some seedling diseases. Also, seedling diseases may be more problematic in fields that have minimal tillage because soils remain cooler and wetter and thus more conducive for seedling disease development. The right image shows anthracnose survival on unincorporated crop residue can facilitate reinfection of plants the next season. Other cultural practices that can be used to manage disease include planting and harvest dates. Delaying planting date may allow the crop to escape infection and therefore avoid severe disease, for example, seedling blights. Similarly, planting earlier can also be a disease management tool, such as avoiding Phytophthora damping off. Harvesting plants in a timely manner is another good management practice since it reduces colonization of the host and subsequent disease development. Good agronomic practices that include planting at the recommended plant population and managing fertility and weeds help reduce disease by limiting stress on the host plant. If crops are planted at higher than the recommended plant populations, competition for light, water, and nutrients can increase susceptibility to disease. Weeds stress crops by competing for light and nutrients. For example, St. Augustine grass that is deficient in nitrogen tend to be more prone to getting dollar spot. Fungicides can be used to manage disease, but they should be used in combination with other management practices. Fungicides are available as seed treatments and protect the germinating seed from infection by soil-borne pathogens. Almost all hybrid corn is treated with seed treatments to protect them from damping off. Fungicides can also be applied to the leaves of crop plants. Depending on which chemical group the fungicide belongs to, they could stop germination of the spore and thus infection of the host. Or they prevent growth of the fungus and consequently colonization of the host tissue. Chemical application does not eliminate the disease symptoms present at the time of the application, but rather protects uninfected plant tissue. The diagram above shows the steps of infection and lesion pustule formation for rust diseases. In general, fungicides are most effective when applied before disease is established in a field. Before using a foliar fungicide, there are several factors that need to be taken into consideration. First of all, what is the risk of a disease? Has the disease been a problem in that area before, and thus could the pathogen have survived on previous crop residue? Is the host plant susceptible to disease, or does it have resistance to the disease of concern? If the host is resistant to the prominent diseases, the fungicide may not be needed. At what stage of the growing season is disease becoming an issue? Disease early in the growing season is more likely to reduce yield than diseases that arrive at the end of the growing season. So treatments with a fungicide are more critical when diseases appear earlier in the season. Fungicides have no effect on bacterial, viral, or nematode diseases. The profitability of a fungicide application depends on costs associated with the application and the price of seed. So now we have discussed various management practices. Let's go back to the disease cycle and illustrate how the practices interrupt the disease cycle. Rotation, tillage, and planting high-quality seed interrupt the disease cycle by reducing the amount of inoculum available for infection. This often delays the onset and/or severity of disease. The image shows a corn leaf with symptoms of eye spot. Eye spot is a disease which may be minimized by crop rotation and tillage. Disease resistance and fungicides stop the disease cycle by preventing infection or stopping colonization of the host tissue. The image shows a soybean leaf with symptoms of frog eye leaf spot. Frog eye leaf spot is a disease which may be minimized by planting resistant varieties and fungicide application. In summary, a plant disease cannot develop if a susceptible host, pathogen, and favorable environment do not occur simultaneously. The disease cycle describes the interaction of the pathogen with the host. Knowing the disease cycle is the foundation for plant disease management. Although we have four types of pathogens that can cause disease on plants, the disease cycle is essentially the same for all of them. The most effective disease management strategies break the disease cycle. Understanding the disease cycle and how management strategies break the disease cycle will enable the most effective strategies to be used for plant disease management.